So I'm Jen Thompson, and Casey Burkholder and I recently edited a book with Rutledge called Field Notes in Qualitative Education and Social Science Research, Approaches, Practices, and Ethical Considerations. Today, Casey and I are talking with Siak van der Geest, Professor Emeritus of Medical Anthropology at the University of Amsterdam. In his important chapter with Janneke Verheyen from Leiden University, called Co-Production, Friendship, and Transparency in Anthropological Field Notes, Siak and Janneke discuss the critical and yet often unacknowledged role of research assistants in field notes production.
Can you talk about how you take field notes?
Normally, we had a routine of at the end of the day, I was together with my friend. No, I couldn't call him an assistant really, but he was an assistant, I think. But he was also a very good friend. We were sitting together when the people went to bed, and we had a small kerosene lamp, and we sit together and we started writing. That was the daily routine. But sometimes, if something happened in daytime and you want to quickly write it down, then you rush to your room and wrote it, and we had about two or three books for different purposes. So we were always busy in those books, writing down the field notes. Yeah. And also the transcription. No, because we recorded a lot, but we didn't want to wait till the end of the field work and to do all those prescriptions would be terrible. So we did the transcription and talked about it. So the difference between transcription and field notes was not always so big. They were of the same kind, you could say. Yeah. And when I saw your announcement of your plans for the book, it struck something in me, because field notes have always been very dear to me. They meant the real part of the field work. And still, because of the article that you wrote, I went back to my field notes. The whole situation of 30, 40 years ago came back, because they contain the situation in which you were, the emotional thing, the quarrels we had. And so field notes are for me the raw experience of doing field work, and so that's somehow what we, and then I realized, and it is also explained in the title of our article, that there were, for me, linked up with those three things. Now, it was a very concrete way of working together with my friend, where we were both writing in the same notebooks. So it felt like we're doing something together. And secondly, that is almost closely linked to it. It also made our relationship better, because you felt you were in the same boat. You were doing the same thing. So I wanted to write about that. Also because I was always thinking about the anthropologist and his or her assistants. It's a long discussion. Sanjak is writing about it, etc. So I wanted to bring that in, because for me it was an opportunity to show the importance of the so-called assistant. And then I thought of Janneke, because she is my student. I supervised her, and I think she's one of my best students ever. And she had also a very maybe unusual situation and of working with an assistant. And she just, you know, she explains and describes this in her part of the article. So I thought, let us tell the same story, you about your fieldwork and I about my fieldwork. Because when I visited her in the field in Malawi, I saw how the two of them moved together and how important her assistant was to her, you see. So that's the, and then in the case of Janneke, there was an additional thing, namely her idea of bringing the field notes into her dissertation. And she explains that in the article, and she shows how she did it. So if you read only the digital version of her book and her PhD, you can always click and you enter right into the field notes, which is fantastic. And it's I think it's hardly done. And now, but with today's technology, it's quite simple. So that is something that she brought in, and then I realized that my field notes are in a sense secret. You know, they are my personal, my personal papers, and no one, you know, the people just have to believe what I am saying. You know, the reader cannot check from my field notes how I reached that conclusion and how I wrote the ethnography. So these were some of the comparisons we made together, and we explained that in the end. And in the conclusion of our article, I realized that a few differences, but the most important and most interesting difference, I think, for your book is that in my time, I was open, of course, about Kwasi's contribution, but I did not expand on it. I did not reflect on how he was, you know, how his position was in the production of the ethnography. And it was and 40 years or 30 years later, Janneke did it much better. You see, so that is the I think somehow the summary of the article and my motivation to write that article.
What do you think researchers need to know about field notes?
I reached another. I brought in another concept, which I think is very crucial in the production of the field notes, and will also be, I think, relevant. That's answer to your question for students who are now going out to doing field work. And that concept is serendipity. I realized that now my research was full of coincidences and little planned. You know, I entered the field, I think I described it briefly, I'm not sure even, but I entered the field without a clear question, which is of course not allowed today, but I was a student in Ghana, in the University of Ghana, and I think I could convince my supervisor, a Ghanaian professor, to allow me to just go into the field, hang around there, and decide on what direction the research would take. The only idea I had was I was brought up in the structural functionalist tradition mostly, and you know, as you probably know from the study of the history of anthropology, that structural functionalism tended to paint quite a romantic, harmonious picture of society and family life, etc. So I was suspicious, and I thought this is too nice to be true. So I thought I'll just sit there and see what's happening and see whether it functions so well as the anthropologists are assuming. It's just described in the article, things happened which we never expected, you see. So my master thesis, that was my research, took a direction because of one event that took place after 1 or 2 months in the field, a big fight in the family about the burial of a member of the family. See, and yeah. So the field notes have recorded, as it were, that moment where we took another direction or we found a direction. And later on, small things happened, which I also described in the article, that you think you're going that way, then suddenly you see something or someone talks to you or something happens, and then you have to, again, change your direction somewhat. So there is serendipity, and the consequence of this serendipity in research is that you have to improvise all the time. So improvisation, these are two terms which I don't think in our article, but I think they are important. You have to improvise, which is something that scientists are not supposed to do in most disciplines. But I think we, in our case, we have to all the time. Life is full of coincidences. So how can you write a fixed research plan from your desk in Amsterdam going to another place and stick to it? Now, of course, you can have a plan, but you should always be ready to adjust, because the questions that you thought were important prove to be not important, or even completely out of reason, not relevant. So life is messy and not well organized. So how can research be fixed and that's what I like about the field notes. And I think we should also teach our students that they should always be ready to expect the unexpected. And I call it, I have a term for that. I call that, maybe someone else said it before me, I'm not sure, but you call that the permanent receptivity. Permanent receptivity. And in the life that I was living with my friend in that rural town in Ghana was permanent in the literal sense of the word, because my research did not take place from 9 o'clock in the morning till 5 o'clock in the afternoon. It was 24 hours, day and night. Some of the most exciting things happened after sunset, you see. So the permanent receptivity is a possibility that is given to us through the permanent presence, which is in participant observation, staying with the family, and et cetera, et cetera. And that is something that, with modern types of research, digital and electronic possibilities, may be lost, or it have to be, perhaps they can translate it into new technical tools that are available to us. I'm not sure. It's not my strong point, the technology, as you have noticed a few minutes ago. But so I think that is what students should learn, that they should expect the unexpected.